That was incredible.
That's it.
Man.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming out.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Ashley Richard Pearson. Is that right?
That's my full name.
Known as Ash Pearson.
That's right.
Now, Ash, you've been a drum instructor for 2 years.
Yeah.
And you recently got the gig playing with Revocation.
That's right.
Which is the two songs you just played there.
Yes, that's right.
So the first song was called Madness Opus.
That's right.
And the next song was Terada Genesis.
That's how I pronounce it. I think that's what it's called, Terada Genesis.
Or Teradada? No.
Terada Genesis.
Yeah. That's great, man. You know, it's such a... I haven't listened to a ton of Revocation, but listening to it sounds so cool because it's so groove-based.
Yeah.
And the it's not, you know, it's not all like super straight and blast beats,
but yeah.
It's got a lot of depth to it.
There's a lot of room for taste and moving around and stuff like that. And I'll give my homage, tip my hat to the previous drummer, Phil Dubois, who's a good friend of mine, who I recently just took over his chair, so I'm very honored by that. Phil is a great drummer. And honestly, like a lot of these parts are ones that I might have written myself, you know what I mean? Because
right.
the guitar work and everything, it's all very progressive, but there's got some classic metal to it, and it's even got like some cool jazz kind of phrasing almost, so there's a lot of room to really get creative with this music.
Nice. Yeah. Man, well, as like from Drumeo, we're all like super proud of you, because when we first got connected, you were playing with 3 Inches of Blood.
Yes, that's right.
Which is another popular metal band, and mm-hmm. I guess you guys are in a little bit of a hiatus, or...
Yeah. Yeah, we're pretty much breaking up.
But now you got the gig with Revocation, and
yeah.
you were just on tour in Mexico,
mm-hmm.
and that's great. Like, it's cool to see, you know, our Drumeo instructors, our kind of faculty instructors, really kind of move their way up the corporate ladder, so to speak. And now you got your signature stick cup over here.
Yeah. And I got my signature table and everything. Yeah, thanks, man. I appreciate that. That's awesome.
It's great to have you here.
Thanks.
You've been doing clinics as well.
Mm-hmm.
You've done a bunch of those. You did them recently at Long & McQuaid.
Yep.
Locally. And if you guys want to connect with Ash, you can find him on Facebook. Just search his name, Ash Pearson, or Twitter, it's at Ash Pearson 2, and Instagram is at Ash Pearson 123.
Yeah.
So today we're going to talk about how to audition for a band, and when we were discussing this lesson,
mm-hmm.
I'm just like, this is what it's got to be.
You
just had a pretty... a big audition with the Revocation, and in the past you also auditioned with Dillinger Escape Plan.
That's right. Right. Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be cool if you told us a little bit about that.
Yeah, and I mean, would you like me to dive into the lesson content now and kind of relate it to?
Sure, we can do that. Before we get started, I just want to mention one thing. For those of you who have never been to a Drumeo lesson before, we do this sort of thing every day. So we have a new live lesson, and the purpose of it is to give you some great new things to work on the drum set, as well as answer some questions. And so at the end of the lesson, if you have any questions for Ash, right below the video player, you'll see a submit a question box. Just hit that and type in your question, and we're going to get to as many as possible near the end of the lesson.
You bet.
Another thing is if you'd like to try out Drumeo, this is what I tell everyone who doesn't really know what we do inside of Drumeo. It's awesome, and obviously I'm very, very biased. So we just want to give you a free 30-day trial. You can try it out and see if it's right for you. So if you go to drumeo.com/trial, it's free for the first 30 days, and if you don't like it, that's no problem. You can go ahead and cancel. You'll never be billed. But I'd really just love for all of you guys to try it out. So
you got some great instructors on there. I mean, you know, I use Drumeo. I watch the Thomas Pridgen episode a lot. Like, I've, you know, certainly on a practical, just watching it on YouTube. But with the Drumeo courses and stuff like that that you have, I've been going over the Matt Garska one a bunch. The creating. Freedom by Using Systems, I think it's called. And it's really great because it's just like it goes step by step. It gives you certain things to build on, you know what I mean? It's really practical, and I do use it, and it's awesome because you have some really heavy players on there, which is great.
Yeah, we have exclusive courses from Thomas Lang, Benny Greb, Peter Erskine, Matt Garska, Larnell Lewis, mm-hmm. and like lots of more great drummers. So
that's awesome.
All right, let's get into this.
Yeah.
How to audition for a band. This is like a terrifying thing for a lot of drummers.
Yeah.
And I've auditioned for a couple bands. I didn't get one of them.
Really?
Which was pretty disappointing.
That's surprising because you're such a great drummer.
Thanks, Ash.
Yeah, well, it's true.
So tell us, what is your kind of mentality when going into audition, and how do you approach this sort of thing?
So I'll break it down to like a few things. You know, before an audition happens, people have to know that you're out there. You know what I mean? If you're always practicing your basement and you never get out of the house or never make a video or something like that, no one's gonna know that you exist, right? Mm-hmm. So that would be putting yourself out there is a really huge component of getting an audition in the first place. You know, a lot of people are very shy. Not a lot of people, but I've definitely met some who they don't feel confident enough to even go out there. And there's a really famous Wayne Gretzky quote that if you you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. So sometimes it's more important not to be the best, but to just be someone who's proactive, because that's how you get good. You know what I mean? No one's going to be really at the level that they currently want to be at. Everyone wants to strive to do better. So the more you put yourself out there, the more you'll learn. And there's lots of different ways to put yourself out there too. It doesn't always come down to, you know, going and knocking on people's doors and, you know, being like, hey, can I audition for your band or something like that. There's lots of ways. Making videos is a great way to do that. Going to concerts is a great way to do that too, because then you meet other players, be it local players or people who are coming in from out of town. And I've just straight up like knocked on people's doors and been like, hey, that was a great show. My name's Ash Pearson. How are you? You know, and this was before I had any real affiliation with any band. You know, like I never had a name that I could be like, hey, I play for so-and-so. You know, I was just some guy, right? But the key is to, you know, just be to approach people and be approachable. And I'll expand on that a little bit later. But that and the first thing I said, should have said first was the craft. You know, you have to be dedicated to playing drums and to playing music and your instrument and stuff like that too. Because that's, at least to me, that's what should come first. You know, that's the one thing that will continue to pay dividends for the rest of your life, is to educate yourself and to just keep playing, man, because you know, bands come and go. Like all these bands you're gonna go audition for, which we'll cover, they'll come and go, but what remains is your desire and drive to want to play, right? Mm-hmm. And that's the thing that's always sustained me, is like, I don't know where I'm gonna land necessarily, but I just love to play so much and I have to play. And that's what has always kept me moving forward, you know?
Yeah.
And that's a great thing. So I'd say those two things are really essential before you even get started auditioning for a band. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like the one thing about putting yourself out there, I know, like personally, I don't know how I guess I don't really know how I come off on video, but some people might think, oh, he's like really talkative or outgoing, but those that have met me, like the VIP students who probably come out here and other people, know that I'm not like super outgoing and loud in the room. At least I don't think I am.
Right.
So that really doesn't, I see you do it. Like he'll make a point to come out, and if there's a drummer out at Drumeo, he like texts me, can I come say hello? Like, you're Mr. Networking, man, which is crazy. Like we were at NAMM and he's like, oh, you wanna meet Gene Hoagland? I don't know how it came up, but 20 minutes later, he's bringing in Gene Hoagland, who I don't even know how you met him, but that's probably part of this whole, how you network and stuff. So maybe you can tell us a little bit about that.
Definitely, yeah. I'm kind of, I don't shamelessly self-promote, but I shamelessly am just always up to, for a good time, you know, for the most part. A lot of this, a large part of my outlook has to do with what I learned from Gene. He's one of my oldest friends, drummers, and one of my oldest teachers too. He's like, for those of you who don't know, he's probably the best metal drummer there is out there. He played in Dark Angel, Death, Death Clock, Fear Factory, Strapping a Lad, my personal favorite, Zimmer's Hole. He's currently playing with Testament, and he's out on the Death Tall tours and stuff, and he has a couple instructional DVDs and stuff, and I mean, he's just the best. Anyways, I started playing when I was like 12, and I really started gigging when I was like 15 or 16. And as a funny footnote to this, I was in a band like Slipknot and whatever, and then someone one day was like, hey, can you play this? And they played me a Strapping record. And I was like, I don't even know what that is. I don't even know what he's doing. Like, that's drumming I've never heard. Like, I was on this level, and then I heard this, and that's what Gene was doing. I was like, I don't even know. That's so cool. And when Strapping a Lad was a Vancouver band, they broke up in 2006. But when Gene was living here, he was always going to local shows. Like if he wasn't playing, he was always just at the scummy bars where I was playing music, right? So at some point along the way, he just came and introduced himself, you know, like me, kind of. He's a gregarious character. Like, he'll go and just start meeting people and approaching people and, you know, making, he's one of the best, but he makes everybody feel like they're valued and that they're on an even keel, you know what I mean? And he doesn't make them feel small, which is great. So I learned a humble attitude from him, because if someone can be the best at something and yet still embrace people, then that's fantastic. But yeah, I met him when I was 16 and I didn't know who he was, but someone's like, hey, that's the guy, that's Gene.
Right.
I'm like, that guy, he's huge. And he's like, hey, daddy, how's it going? My name's Gene. I really like your playing. I'm like, thanks. I like your playing too. So I just basically became his shadow for the next 4 or 5 years or something like that. I would drum tech for him on records. I'd drum tech for him live. I would go to Strapping a Lad practices and jams and stuff like that, and I'd just hide behind a speaker and whatever. I'd stay up with him till the sun came up, just talking about drums and like the philosophy of drumming and stuff like that. And one of the main things I got from him to, because I could prattle on and on about what he taught me, but one of the main things that he told me was that drumming is 90% mental and is 10% physical. Now, for someone with such a fantastic physical ability, you know, it's really interesting just the things that he does, and it's also always so fresh, and you know, he's got a great mind for this kind of thing. And then eventually it kind of, right around the time he moved out of town, it came to a crux where, like, he played in several local bands besides Strapping a Lad, which wasn't really a local band, but they were based out of Vancouver. He played in one called Punch Drunk, which is where I met Shane from 3 Inches of Blood. And then he played in another band called Just Cause. And so then he left town, sort of, and I became the new drummer for Just Cause. I sort of auditioned, but it was, you know, I just like learned the tunes and, you know, I had the right kind of vibe, I guess.
Yeah.
So anyways, like right around the time Gene was leaving town, him and I sat down in a room and I just played all these Just Cause songs that I learned for the guy who wrote them. And then he's like, that's pretty good, but this part I'm doing specifically this. And then he'd show me what he was doing. I'm like, oh yeah, oh, very cool. I didn't know that's what you were doing. So I learned a lot in that short period of time. And at our first show, you know, I played the set, and then for the second to last song, he came and sat on my drum set and played a new song. And it was almost like he was passing me the torch. And it was a really fantastic moment. And I'm still friends with him till this day. I mean, I love him. But back then, that's what that meant to me. And that's kind of the path it got me set off on. I was just so fired up, you know, and I still am.
That's cool. Yeah. So you talked about preparing before auditioning. Mm-hmm. You talked about putting yourself out there. Mm-hmm. Let's talk a little bit about the audition process. How do you work that?
Yeah, excellent. So, you know, if you get an audition, someone said, like, yeah, I'll come give you a shot. If they don't know, like, this is kind of under the assumption that they have no idea who you are and whatever, you know. Some of you who have done many auditions, you probably already are aware of the process and have conducted yourself accordingly, you know, because there's a bit of a learning curve with it, right?
Right.
But if you go in cold, I would say obviously learning the music, right? Learning the music is one of the main things. I basically taught myself how to play drums more or less by playing along to records. So approximating other people's drum parts and like making them my own has always been something I've had a knack for, and it might be something you have to do. And it won't always come down to playing Beatles songs or something like that. I mean, obviously, if you're gonna audition for a cover band, you might want to play as much to the original recording as possible. But when it comes to, like, say, joining someone's original band, right? Say they have a recording that's like 5 songs they want you to learn or something like that. You know, I'd say learn them as best as you can, but know where there is the spots where you can get in and do what you would have done, or just what, you know, how to make the song your own. So you, there's certain like signature licks and turnarounds and accents, like all those things you really need to try and nail. But there's certain maybe little things like fills and stuff like that. So you can learn the original fill, but then also think about something that you would play, because that might excite or surprise the person who you're playing for. You know, you show a little bit of a creative initiative, which is great. So yeah, you got to learn the songs. You know, slowing them down is huge. A huge thing for me, especially with really dense material. Something like when I had to, like when I was auditioning for Revocation, I mean, the guys knew me, so on an interpersonal level, we kind of had a thing going, but they wanted to see some audition videos. So I just sat and woodshedded for like 2 days. And I honestly wasn't even really behind the drums all that much, because I know how to play kind, right? I do. Mm-hmm. A lot of what I was doing was just listening and listening and listening 100 times over to 2 songs, and I would put it into a program called the Amazing Slowdowner. If you guys haven't heard of it, it's not much of a name, but it is what it is. That's what it does. It slows down music and keeps the pitch, which is, it's a fantastic tool for drummers and for guitarists alike. So I would slow it down, and just like I'd go through, I'd use the old Fowler brothers from the Frank Zappa band. They would go through a song, and they play it until they didn't know what it was, or until they messed up, and then they'd go back and play it again until they made it all the way through. So I would take that approach. I'd listen, be really thorough with everything, and just go through part by part. And then, I listened for like 2 days, made 2 videos in an afternoon with all the preparation that I had done, and mailed it off to them. They were like, oh, yeah, let's bring him out on tour.
So here's a question. Mm-hmm. With the videos and stuff, because I know a lot of auditions these days are going to be on video.
Yeah.
Because I think bands feel like they have a larger pool to pick from, especially if they're a well-known band like Revocation. You could just go on YouTube and type Revocation drum cover, and you're going to find lots of drummers that are playing.
That's true.
Along to that music. So how important was it for you to really spend a lot of time on the video, or how much time did you spend on the videos? And should a drummer who's considering auditioning for a band like go and pay to have it professionally filmed and recorded at a studio, or what do you recommend?
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's really interesting. I mean, part of me says, yeah, like go try and make it as professional looking as you can and pay the money, or just like, you know, as much as you can do on your own out of your own initiative is always a great thing. You know, if you have the mics, if you have the programs, if you want to put in the time to make it all work, get the sounds, and you can self-produce, and that's fantastic. And lots of people do that, you know. There are lots of great guys out there who just, they make their own videos, or they have a friend help them out or something like that.
Yeah.
It's worth doing, definitely, because the sound and the presentation really is a good foot to put forward, you know?
Right.
Most of the ones that I've ever made have been pretty crude, you know? But the fact that I was making them and the fact that I was doing things right kind of just showed. You know, the playing really spoke for itself, and even though the production wasn't as top-notch as it could be, it still came through. So
I feel like that would be a priority over the production. Like, don't put too much into the production and then have really
crappy playing,
not really good drumming.
Yeah,
and then it's like, oh, this sounds good, it looks good, but you can't play the tunes. So.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So yeah, I would say, you know, just make videos. Like, I have a GoPro. And I'll just use a GoPro. Excuse me, a GoPro. That those work great, and there's lots of good cameras out there that will get your point across. But as long as you kind of have the playing the playing under control. Yeah. For sure. So that's one part of it. Learn the music, and we'll go through. You know, I can go through like a little bit of how I learned like a dense part in a revocation song.
Right.
It's like a, you know, a 10-second part or whatever, and show you what I did and whatever, and you speed it up and whatever. But
sure.
So you know, but you the second part would be kind of like the. It's all kind of comes down to an interpersonal thing because the playing is huge. But think about it. You're on stage for an hour of the day with these people who you want a job with, and then you're spending the subsequent 23 hours with them. They want someone who they can hang with, you know? That's a big part of it. You know, it doesn't mean that if you're the coolest guy but you're the crappiest player, you're gonna get the gig or something like that. There has to be a balance somewhere. But as far as first impressions go, I wouldn't come on too strong, you know? I would sort of sit and listen and observe, you know, and see what their dynamic is, you know, and try and just like do your best and let your playing speak for itself. And then, you know, it's the rest should evolve naturally from there. You know what I mean? You can start to bring out different sides of your personality and stuff like that instead of just throwing it all out on the table at once, right?
Yeah. I feel like, I know we chatted a little bit before this, and we talked about becoming a chameleon, just to try and blend in, especially, I swallowed, it came right through the mic. but trying to really blend in, I hope I'm not like ruining what you're gonna say,
nope.
And I find a lot of people when they have great personalities, but sometimes they lay it on a little bit too thick when they meet new people.
Yeah.
And the new people are like, whoa, is this guy always so intense? Because they're really trying to make an impression.
Yeah, yeah.
And I always find like when I meet new people, especially a new band that I'm playing with, I try my best just to like blend in, be quiet, don't give any feedback on the music yet, don't act like you've been there for the last 5 years.
Yeah.
But try and just like make everyone else feel really comfortable.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's I think it's worked fine for me, I don't know.
Definitely, because then they'll, you know, eventually, if you're there long enough, they'll take an interest in you. They'll be like, okay, so that guy's just sitting there quiet. Well, people aren't quiet. You know, and it doesn't mean that he has nothing to say. So what's he got to say? And then eventually you can start talking about different things. Also, it's like, and speaking to being a chameleon, if you have many different interests, it makes you interesting. So think about it. I mean, not every member of a band drinks. You can't just be a drunk and expect that everyone's gonna like you. You know, even if you're a happy drunk or whatever. Because maybe the guitar player is straight edge and doesn't drink, but whatever. You know, say he likes to read books. You know, you should be able to talk on different levels with people, which is a great thing. It can be a real asset to you, you know. If people know that, because I mean, finding good help is hard to find. It's a tough thing, especially in metal sometimes, because there's a lot of people who. Have pretty strong vices sometimes, you know what I mean? Drinking, drugs, and stuff like that. And they want at least to know that you can, you know, that you've got other things on your priority list than just, you know, getting messed up all the time. So if you can, you know, movies, books, music, art, you know, philosophy, history, all this stuff, I mean, don't be afraid to, you know, whip that out of your bag of tricks and stuff like that, because talking with people on different levels, you'll learn things for one, and then for two, you'll come off good. You'll be interesting to people too, which would also, lead me into like, you know, keep your vices in perspective. You know what I mean? It comes back to being more about the craft too. Am I more concerned with, you know, ditching out of practice or not having a good practice because I'm too stoned or drunk or something like that? It's, you know, play, have this come first, you know what I mean? You can have your fun and stuff like that when it's time, but this is more important in the long run, you know what I mean? At least I think it is, so, you know, and that really shows when people see you, they know you got your mind on this and therefore on the band, you know, and that's a great first impression to give.
Yeah, cool. And then you have something about being ready to land the gig.
Mm-hmm.
And what do you mean by that?
Well, say you get the gig, And that means all of a sudden means that you're a member, and members typically contribute, you know? I mean, not every member, like, and if someone's programming every single drum lick and saying, here, play this, maybe you're not contributing as much as you'd like, but you're part of a team all of a sudden, you know? And there's lots of things that goes into being part of the team. It's not just playing drums. It's loading your drums. It's loading other people's gear.
Right.
You know, it might not be what you signed up for, but I mean, just be ready for that kind of thing, you know? And but that, again, your willingness to do that kind of thing makes you a real asset to people. So, you know, you gotta help them fold the banner, help them load the cabs, right. Help them set up the merch, tend the merch, do some of the driving and stuff mm-hmm. like that, pump the gas. I mean, there's all this stuff that goes into it that you might not have thought about. It's not always, I mean, unless you land an awesome gig where all that stuff is taken care of for you, then my congratulations to you, because that's a rare thing to come across. But you know, if you can be aware that that's all part of the game, and to take the initiative to do all those things when they're needed out of you, or you rise to the occasion, then again, it's a great asset, and people take notice of that kind of thing. You know?
I really think that you know, a lot of the auditions lately are probably like actual gig auditions. Like, I know you've done that before, where before they decide whether or not you're in the band, you'll actually go play a few gigs with them.
Yeah,
and and at that point, if you're doing this extra stuff and they're comparing you to another player, and the other player is just playing drums, but you're playing drums in the same exact way, your personality, you're hanging out more, mm-hmm. you're helping with the merch, you're loading in the guitar player's stuff, or at least helping, mm-hmm. That goes a long way into like how committed you are and their perception of you. I think that's really important.
Big time. And I mean, musical direction is another aspect of that too. You, like I said, you're a contributing member all of a sudden, so hence another good reason as to why to talk about music and mm-hmm. stuff like that with some of the members, because you're going to be contributing. So like with the Revocation guys, for example, I spent 2 months in Europe with them as part of my audition. Like I sent them those two videos, but you know, I mean, at the time, their drummer was just, he was away, and he couldn't play, so they needed some guys, but mm-hmm. You know, I guess it was part of the audition process. I mean, you know, we didn't know it at the time, but, you know, we spent like 45 days together or something like that, and played a whole bunch of shows. So they knew I could play, they knew I could hang. But at that time they didn't need a drummer. So, I mean, that's fine. It was just it was a good time and a cool experience. But, you know, we obviously got to talking about music and all this stuff, and got a chance to talk about a lot of things. And then eventually when they did need someone, it kind of came back to me, and they were like, Ash could hang, and you know, he could play, and we know he's on a similar musical page as us too. He can be a contributing member and stuff. So you know, I'm really looking forward to the next record that Revocation is going to do. It'll be my first with them, but we've been writing a lot. If any of you guys know the track record of this band, they do almost an album a year, which is really rare, especially in the metal world these days. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Dave's sending me lots of stuff, and I'm really excited about it. It's sounding great. And obviously I'm not going to be playing like the old drummer, Phil, because I'm not him. But, yeah. I mean, all you can do is to try and just fill the shoes as best you can, and try and, you know, play it how you would play it. So
right,
yeah,
that's cool, man.
Yeah,
we're gonna get into another song here now. And I thank you very much for all those helpful tips. I hope for any of you who are auditioning for a band, hopefully some of these tips are gonna help you maybe get that gig.
So. Yeah. Oh, and maybe I should touch on that Dillinger Escape Plan thing too.
Good.
Yeah, because that was one of the only real auditions that I did. But I was 21 at the time, so it was, 2006 or something like that. It was a while ago. Again, it was kind of when YouTube was fresh, at least to me. It was new to me. I made a video of me playing one of their songs, and I didn't even have the sound on. It was just me doing the hits. So all they heard was the track, and then they just saw me doing the notes and stuff like that. Anyways, Chris Penny was just leaving the band, but no one knew it. And then I got a message from Greg, the singer, and was just like, it looks like you can play our stuff. Can you? And of course, I wasn't going to say no. I said, yeah, I can play your stuff. But like I said, I was 21 at the time. I mean, I had been playing like less than 10 years. And I flew down to New Jersey where I met Ben in New York. He picked me up and we drove down to New Jersey together and just started playing right away. But it was really funny because they had still had a jam space with Chris Penny's drums in it. And where all their gear was, they're like, we need to go get our gear. We're gonna go jam at my house. And then they get in and they're like, oh man, the door is locked and Chris is the only guy with the key. And so we proceed to break into their jam space with like a screwdriver and a credit card or something like that. We were trying a bunch of things and we got in and there was Chris Penny's drum set. And Chris Penny was and still is like a huge influence on me, you know? And back then, like I was all about the Dillinger Escape Plan at the time. And here I am, you know, auditioning for them, which was amazing. So they're like, well, since we're here, why don't you just play his drums? So I'm like, oh my God, I'm sitting on Chris's drum set. And then I just counted off the song and We played like five songs, Panasonic Youth and 43% Burnt. I mean, it was really cool. They were filming me and stuff like that. I mean, there was like a lot of pressure, right?
Yeah.
And I was able to play the songs, but I think probably at the time, I might not have been the right guy for the job. I never bombed or anything from what I can remember, but there's this also, I will say from experience, it's good, even if you're doing metal and stuff like that, to get foundations in different styles of music. You know what I mean? Even if that's not what you're gonna specialize in, you know, I didn't really know much about jazz or Latin when I auditioned with Dillinger, but if I had, it would have been an asset to me because they have all those little elements in their music, even though you might not pick up on it. So that being said, they went in and did a record, and then right around the time they were doing the record, I got the call to go join 3 Inches of Blood. So, you know, they had their studio drummer, Gil, ended up touring with them for a couple of years, and that worked out great for them. And 3 Inches of Blood worked out great for me because they're a Vancouver band, and that's where I'm from. So, but it was a fantastic experience. It was way, way above my experience level. I had never toured or anything like that at the time, but they were my favorite band. And I got to jam with them. You know, I spent like 5 days or something like that. And yeah. I learned a lot from it. So, you know, I could have easily stayed home and said like, no, I'm too afraid. Right. But, you know, even though I didn't, you know, get that gig, it was still a fantastic experience. I learned a lot from, and it led to other things. So, right. Yeah.
Cool, man.
Yeah.
All right, we're gonna get into a song.
Yes.
The song is called Deathless.
Deathless, yeah. This is off the new record, Revocation's new record called Deathless. And it's the lyrical content is about just the band being a heavy touring band, you know, traversing long distances and across night and day and, and experiencing the decibel ritual that is playing loud music in front of a crowd. Yeah.
Nice. Great job, man.
Thanks, man.
You've gotten, like, since you started at Drumeo, you've gotten so much better.
You think?
And you were all like, well, yeah, I hope so. But you were already really good, and now you're like...
Oh, you mean it?
Yeah,
oh, thanks. I appreciate that, man.
Okay, let's get into the questions because there's quite a few.
Okay.
This is from Aaron L81, and I know we're going to probably get a few questions about gear, so I just wanted, as quickly as possible, give us a quick rundown on what you're using here. I know you've got some official endorsements, mm-hmm. and maybe you can just... maybe you can just quickly give us a breakdown.
You bet. So I'm with... actually, it's just kind of interesting that my lesson happens today, but Vic Firth I'm with, and Vic Firth just passed away.
Yeah, it's horrible.
Yeah. So thank you, yeah. Vic Firth. Vic Firth Sticks, I'm with Evans Heads, Sabian Cymbals, and as of recent, Tama Drums. So I'm playing Tama Star Classics right now, Maples. At least I got a little bit of a mix with the two bass drums.
Yeah, this Tama kit is actually our Drumeo. This the Tama kit we have here at Drumeo. Mm-hmm. So Matt Garska played this as well, but yeah. It only has one bass drum and four toms, I believe. And
yeah.
So you went and brought in an extra bass drum.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So I got two Chinas here. One is a Neil Peart Paragon 19-inch. This one is the Chad Smith Holy China, which is great. I got a 20-inch AA Explosion. I like the AAX and the HH Explosions. These are both 20-inch cymbals. And I got the, I think it's a 24-inch AA Rock Ride, which is great.
It's 24, hey, that sounds great.
I think it's a 24. It's a great ride.
It's like a 22.
22?
No, yeah, I don't want to correct you or anything.
It could be. I don't know. I played the hell out of it because the label is pretty much gone, but it's got a great sounding bell. And AA medium hats and HH medium thin hats.
Yeah.
And an air splash and an AAX splash right here. Yeah, so... I've been playing Sabian cymbals since I was just a wee lad, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm really happy to be endorsed with them. It's very cool.
Man. Congrats. Thanks. And you're using a Tama Iron Cobra hi-hat pedal and then Pearl.
Yeah, Pearl Eliminator pedals. I've had an affinity for these for a long time, but I'd say one of my other favorite pedals is an Iron Cobra pedal. I mean, I've been playing that for a long time too. Also the Camco pedal, which was also made by Tama. It was like, that was pre-Iron Cobra. So if you've ever seen one of those, it looks flimsy, but it's actually really well built.
Yeah.
You know, it's got a single chain. It doesn't have like a full footboard. It's got like, just like, just a part footboard. And like I said, it looks flimsy, but there's nothing on that pedal that doesn't need to be there. And it's really durable. And the mechanics behind it are fantastic. So those are some of my favorite pedals.
Cool. This one's from Drummer64. He says, how can you find a band if you're only 15? And how can you put yourself out there if you're not allowed to get a YouTube account or anything like that? If you can find a way to help me with that, that would be great.
I definitely had some cool parents. They really helped me. It was great to have that kind of support. Mm-hmm. System, although it's not essential, but that was definitely helpful because, you know, they just had enough faith in my good judgment to let me go and play scummy bars. And I was playing in places, when I was 16 and 17, like down on Main and Hastings, which those of you who don't know, but that's a really rough neighborhood in Vancouver, but that's where the shows were. So that's where I would go. To answer your question, though, I mean, you could do things like take out ads. Like, I took out ads back before in Buy Sell and stuff like that. They had like personal ads on there. So I was like, drummer seeking guitarist or whatever. You know, I would take out some ads.
Prefers long walks in the music store.
Yeah, that's right. There weren't too many. I would get some guys, some takers and stuff, but they were usually older than I was, and they're like, I don't know if I want to jam with a kid. But I was good. But they were like, well, you're good, but you're just young. But try and find some people your age, you know? You can, there's so much searching that you can do, and towns aren't usually so small that there's not some other towns around it that you can't just hopefully, you know. And you can, I mean, at the end of the day, man, if you're stuck inside your room and you can't even go out, you know, you can trade and collaborate with people who are across the world. Like, honestly, if you get in touch with some guy who lives in Israel or wherever and say like, hey, you want to start a band, mm-hmm. you know, you can start there. If you want to start producing your own music of some sort, get Reason or whatever, start right. making your own beats and, you know, program drums over top of some stuff that some guy sends you. I mean, there's so many different ways you can get out there.
Cool. Matt Drum says, hey, what's the smallest kit setup you would bring to an audition? And do you ever bring up the toaster strudel commercial in auditions?
For those of you who don't know, I used to be a child actor, which actually I think in retrospect is probably one of the reasons I didn't really care about like going out there and embarrassing myself, you right. know, because I would, I'd go to auditions all the time and I had to be like, hey, I'm Ash Pearson. This is me reading for this product or whatever. You know, again, I was like 8 or something like that, but still, like, it's something you had to go do, and it just translated really well to drums. The smallest drum set I would bring is like however many pieces you feel comfortable with. If it were me, I'd bring my snare, one tom, one rack tom, a floor tom, and a double kick pedal, and maybe like two crashes and a ride, and my hi-hat or something like that, you know?
Yeah.
And also, I mean, I have this big set here, but it's just because, you know, I like it. But if you can, it's also great to try and play on a stripped down set, you know, because it really helps to inspire creativity. You I have a certain amount of voices to work with and see how much you can do, you know?
Cool.
Yeah.
There's a couple questions from Fred, and one I'm laughing because one of them is funny. Fred.
Okay.
He says, hey, Ash. You said when auditioning, you can look for places to show your own style and creativity. However, if it's their original song, do you run the risk of insulting them as if saying you could do it better?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I would say no. I mean, I would, you know, I'd try and play the song as best as I could. Like, if it were just the first stick click and be like, okay, let's see what you got. I'd try and play their song as best as I could.
Yeah.
You know, I'd be trying to nail it as much as I could. Although that being said, and you know, everyone's different. Everyone might play things a little different. You might have hit your crash when the guy hit the splash or something like that. Don't worry about that. But if you have a chance to play it again, you know, no one's gonna be like, get out of here.
Right.
You know, if they were worth a damn, they would just say, hey, that one part in the middle there, you know, when you did it that way, I'd prefer if you did it this other way. I mean, you know, I've been in that situation a couple times where, you know, I've reached and then I had to reel it back in a bit because, you know, it's just what the song, whatever is best for the song, really, you know.
There's one time I auditioned for a band and they recorded their album live, and so the drummer had made a mistake on the album.
Mm.
And I actually played the mistake.
Oh, yeah.
And so one of the things they said is, like, when they heard me actually hit the mistake, they were just like, oh, that's great. So I ended up getting a gig and I played the band for, like, quite a long time.
Oh, that's cool.
Another question, this is the one I was laughing at, another question from Fred.
Yeah.
Is there a way to rehabilitate yourself if you blow a part in the middle of an audition, or should you just pack up your sticks right there?
And there? Right then and there?
Yeah. I can just see you saying this.
Well, I wouldn't do that.
Don't pack up your sticks.
No, I wouldn't do that. No, I mean, I'd either play through it and I'd be like, oh, sorry about that part. I missed it there or whatever. Or I'd stop and be like, wait, I'm sorry about that, guys. Let me just try that again. You know, those are the two things I would do. So
this one's from Cameron Robb. He says, in metal, is double bass actually required?
Like having two bass drums?
Being able to play double bass.
Mm.
That's what I'm assuming.
It's a good question. I wouldn't say it's required because There's like doom bands and stuff. There's lots of different kinds of metal that people just play with one foot.
Right.
And like, I play with two feet double bass because that's what I'm used to. That's what I like. And that's what I'm used to. But there are guys who are so good with their right foot. You wouldn't like I saw Thomas Pridgen play one time, and I was like, yeah. And I ended up meeting him on Drumeo, actually. And I was like, yeah, like, I saw you play this one time, and you were just rocking the double bass. He's like, I wasn't playing double bass with those guys. And I'm like, what? That was just your right foot? Like, I was blown away.
Right.
So, yeah, it's not a requirement. But, I mean, there's that being said, heavy metal is known for its use of double bass. So, yeah. You know, it's definitely worth looking into. That's
for plus.
Sure.
If you're auditioning for a metal band...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they probably expect that you knew how to play double bass.
Yeah.
I think, unless the metal band, their recordings had no double bass on it.
Mm-hmm. True.
This is a great question from Omari Augustine, and he's a Drumeo for Teachers teacher as well. He's got a great little teaching studio set up.
Awesome.
Lots of students, great teacher. He says, I'm here with my students logged on, and I want to know, how do you get over the fear of recording and or posting your video of yourself? That will be their homework for the next class, by the way.
Oh, very good. There's a lot to be said about shameless self-confidence. And just try and be aware that you don't have to be Neil Peart in your actuality. Like, you don't have to be the guy that you're trying, that you have in your head. Like, we all have this idea of ourselves in our mind. At some point, you have to just be like, look, I'm Ash.
I'm Jared.
He's Jared. You're you. And, you know, and that's fine.
That's Taylor.
That's Taylor. Hey, that's Kyle. you see what I'm saying? You know, you don't have to be the next Neil Peart or whatever. Just try and take your influence of what it is that you like and try and make it your own. So play to your strength. Your strengths, I'd say, when you're presenting yourself in a video, you know. If you're trying to do a Foo Fighters song or something like that, don't try and throw in like a gospel chop lick that you just started working on yesterday or something like that because you want to wow everybody, you know what I mean? If you're trying to play something just straight, play it straight, you know? Play what you're good at. And, you know, and if you, like, again, if you flub a few things, don't let that worry you either. You can always redo it, you know? If you're making a video, you can be like, I can't tell you how many takes I've done making my own drum videos. You know, I probably got it either on the first one or on the 15th one, you know? But the key is just persistence, and you'll get it eventually, you know? But just don't let fear rule your life, especially when it comes to putting yourself out there, making videos, you know? You can always do better tomorrow and just build on what you've been laying down.
Yeah.
You'll be fine.
And I think uploading videos and doing that sort of thing is great for students and it's great for professionals because it allows you to put a video up today and then a couple weeks from now put up another video and then a couple weeks later put up another video. And like I look at, even for me personally, I look back at the first videos I was putting online and I look at them now, I'm like, that was horrible.
Yeah.
But
it's
great to look back because it shows you how far you've come. And sometimes when you're struggling with something, you're like, I can't get this, you're really frustrated with yourself, just go back and look at those videos and you get to see how much you've actually progressed. And it's really, really motivating.
Definitely, that's a great point. It's like a time capsule, you know, and it gives you perspective, and perspective's a great thing to have.
Yeah. This one's from Solo Rider. He says, awesome playing, Ash.
Thanks.
How do you have the TM2 set up? Triggers on both kicks, or do you have a snare? Are you adding extra attack?
I've got Roland... RTK, is that this one here?
Oh, man, I'm so not hit
sorry.
To any of the
sorry.
Electronics.
RT10K, yeah. So I got a trigger on each bass drum, and each bass drum I have the same sample, and it's number 111, solid tight. And that's pretty much it. I don't have a trigger on a snare or anything like that. I just and especially live too, I'll do triggers with mics in them too. So the triggers are really beneficial for metal because There's all these different frequencies that are being pushed off the stage. You got your bass, and then you got your mid ranges, which is a lot of what the guitar takes up. You know, so if you're hoping to have your bass drum project and really be solid and heard, then you need to have some different frequencies at its disposal for the sound guy. So part of that is having a microphone, which captures definitely a lot of the low end. And then a trigger, you can help dial in the slap, which is the great thing to have that kind of cuts through a little bit. So I love them. They're great for in-ear monitors too.
Awesome.
Yeah.
This is our last question, and then you're gonna play another song.
Yes.
Yes, it's gonna be great. This is from Adam Wade. He says, do you have any tips on dealing with nerves pre-audition? I'm interested as it's something that generally stopped me from branching out beyond playing with my groups of friends.
Yeah, interesting. Mm.
I think everyone has nerves. Like, what do you do? I know you have a little bit of ritual before you go on and stuff.
Yeah, I have sort of a ritual, a thing that I do before I play. But I mean, even like, I never don't get nervous. Let's put it that way. Like, even before today's lesson, I was a little like, oh man, I hope
barfed 14 times.
That's true. I barfed 15 times actually. No. It's just, I mean, you want to do good, right? Everyone kind of wants to do good. The thing that I find helps is to try and let go of the need to play good. And that gives you freedom from, you know, from failure and stuff like that. That even if you flub a few things, that as long as you're having fun and playing freely, then you're truly playing. Like, you know, if you're telling like, you don't see children who are nervous to just like play and stuff like that. It's happening very naturally, and we look at them and we smile because we're like, oh man, look at that guy. He just doesn't have a care in the world. It's like, well, it's kind of like that with playing, honestly. Yeah. Sometimes, you know, it's like if you're not, I mean, you have to mix discipline with, you know, with freedom and stuff like that. So if you don't feel if you feel free to play, then it will come off natural and people will enjoy watching you and they'll want to see you more. That being said, before I play, I like to meditate, really. I like to just like close my eyes and there's been times where I've been like, I've had nerves and stuff like that. So I'll just close my eyes, right? And I'll take maybe 5 or 10 minutes. And I'll just try and feel my body, where my body's sitting, you know what I mean? I'll just feel my hands and then my arms, so my forearms, and then collarbone, neck, head, upper torso, abdomen, legs, shins, and then feet, you know? Like, I'll go through and I'll kind of examine all those areas, and then I'll make sure to breathe, try and pay attention to my breath. And then you kind of drop the nervousness a little bit when you're done with that whole exercise. It's really, really beneficial. I've had to do it before. We played some shows with Slipknot, you know. There was like 14,000 people there, and I was really nervous to say the least. And I mean, those kinds of things like really saved me. You know what I mean? I would really go towards that than like having a shot and a beer or something like that to try and numb it. I mean, sometimes that helps some people, right? But I'll do that. You know, I'll warm up a bit. I'll drink lots of water. You know, so I'm well hydrated, and just I'll try and get my body and my mind ready to go out and just naturally go play and have fun.
Nice. Awesome. Well, if you guys enjoyed what you saw today and you're not currently a Drumeo Edge student, we would love to just give you a chance to try it out. So if you go to drumeo.com/trial, it's a free 30-day trial, and you can cancel at any time. If you have a full 30 days to try it, you will never get billed. On the 31st day, you get billed. But if you cancel on the 29th day, that's totally cool. No pressure. We just really want you to try it out because we think there's so many cool things in there, so many exclusive lessons from lots of our guest artists, such as Ash and stuff. I'd really encourage you guys to kind of follow him. He's doing some really cool things with Revocation, and you also have some great thoughts. And so follow him on, just go to his website, and you'll find links to everything else. It's ashpearson.com. You'll find his Facebook and his Instagram and his Twitter. Yeah. But yeah, it's exciting to see your growth. You know, I first met you when you were playing 3 Inches of Blood, and that was kind of winding down.
Yeah.
And I've seen you like work really, really hard, and now you hit the big time. You hit the big time, Ash.
I really appreciate that, Jared. I thanks, man. I mean, I just want to keep moving forward and just keep playing, you know, because I love it. So yeah. I'm really just happy I get to come here and play for you guys and do these kinds of things. You know, it really makes me feel good. So
guys and girls, we have guys and girls.
Yes, of course. Gotta love the ladies.
Okay, so the last song we're playing is A Dead Ode to the Grave.
A Dead Ode to the Grave. This is the first song off of Deathless.
Awesome. Yeah. Hey, man. Well, thank you so much.
Thanks, Jared.
Yeah.
Appreciate it, man.